Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our peer group virtual session for the CFO India peer group. My name is Anuradha Mathur. I'm the Managing Director of CFO Collective. Welcome this afternoon for those of you who are joining from Delhi. It's a beautiful rainy afternoon, and for the rest of you, enjoy the weather wherever you are. Our peer group sessions are a part of a series of engagements that we put together for our members. And the idea is to engage on and talk about themes that are relevant, that are contemporary, and where we can take some ideas or insights away from our speaker or from the discussion and almost implement it sort of Monday morning. The thinking behind our peer groups and the sessions, many of you who are familiar with us will know of this term called collective wisdom, right? We can all sit in our corners and think of how to cope with what's going around us, but there is a power in the collective. And that's really the idea behind here, because the things that we are dealing with, the things that we are coping with, are not from the past. We really do encounter situations that are current, for which answers don't lie in history. And therefore, the intention is one, for all of us to come together, but also invite people who have either dealt with or are spending their time thinking about or solving for some of the challenges that all of us feel somewhere in our systems currently. We held our annual conclave a couple of weeks ago, and there was a session there where we talked about coping mechanisms for leaders, and there was a strain there that pushed us to actually talking about what we are looking to talk about today, which is leadership burnout and the emotional agility you require to thrive at work in the face of burnouts or changing environments. So before we get started on today's session, one, I very quickly wanted to take the opportunity to let you know about our next big initiative, which is the 11th annual CFO Next 100, scheduled for 25th November in New Delhi. We look to identify stars amongst our next in line. So all of you who are on this program, on this session, and through people that you know, please do nominate people from your network and encourage other CFOs to nominate their next in lines. Also block the date, because we'd love to see you at our CFO Next 100. With that, I want to move into today's session. Lots of stuff has been happening. There is a conversation around the Great Resignation. Even as people started to talk about the Great Resignation, there was conversation around the Great Regret, that people weren't sure why they did what they did. Organizations don't know whether to respond to the resignation or the regret. Whose market is this? The fact is that the pandemic has changed a lot of rules for all of us. We thought about work a certain way. We thought about colleagues a certain way. We thought about workforces a certain way, but lots has gotten recalibrated. And I think, you know, today when we sit and there's lots of other things happening, there's a war and there's elections and the Queen has passed away, we sometimes seem to forget how debilitating and how transformational the pandemic was for many of us. Things have been put in motion. I'm not sure we have the answers, but certainly there is a need for a recalibration and for all of us to sit and think about what we are seeing. Is it a blip? Is it a response to the pandemic? Has something fundamentally changed? And how are we meant to respond to all of this that is going on? Mental health issues are out there. They are deeper and more prevalent than ever before. Some of us struggle with figuring out the intensity of them. Sometimes we wonder with our workforces, are they just fragile? Because we didn't grow up in an environment where mental health was such a big issue. How seriously do we take it? How do we respond to it? Burnout symptoms, disruptions, uncertainty that are affecting businesses. And some of you may have seen a recent Deloitte survey that says almost 70% of executives consider leaving their jobs for workplaces and spaces that they believe care for their well-being. What does well-being encompass? Organizations that have been so focused on what they can measure, do what you can measure, And if you can't measure it, don't do it. Right? I mean, emotional well-being. How measurable is it? How much can we focus on it? There's a conversation around burnout. I was interestingly at a meeting just 2 hours ago and met somebody who used to be an investment banker, changed lines, does something completely different. And I said, was there a trigger? And he said, you know, it was burnout. I think we don't even recognize burnout. In our conversation with our guest speaker today, you know, as we were planning the session, there is a conversation and a suggestion that a burnout can take 1 to 3 years to heal. What does a burnout look like? You know, there's fatigue, feeling drained, changes in sleep patterns, appetite, lifestyle diseases. I mean, these seem like every day, everywhere around us. Emotionally, anxiety, self-doubt, being irritable, being angry, feeling listless, feeling trapped, feeling stagnant, despite everything being okay around us, feeling a sense of dissatisfaction. I don't know how familiar these are for how many people, but I know that it is more common than it has ever been in the past. So with all of that recognition and some of these questions, you know, do you feel cynical about things around you? How do you feel about this work situation, the people around you? Do you have to drag yourself to work? Are you excited? Do you feel others around you are having to drag themselves to work? There's a lot of these questions that make up the ultimate answer to whether you are facing a burnout or not, or are other people around you facing a burnout. As a leader, what does burnout mean for you, and can you recognize it in your work? How should you respond to it? Any of these things feel true, I think today's session is as important as it can be. We can't overstate its importance. And I'm delighted to welcome Executive Coach Shakun Khanna, who's a Master Facilitator of the Conscious-Based Leadership with the International Center for Contemporary Consciousness. He's going to talk to us about how leaders can manage personal burnout and how they can be emotionally nimble and agile to work through this. He also works at Oracle as Vice President and Head of SaaS Alliances and Channels, but his passion and his commitment to helping people be better and feel better is fundamental to who he is. So I'm delighted to have Shakun with us, and I'm going to ask him to talk us through in his time as an executive coach. I want him to contrast how things have been. You know, he's been doing this for 15 years. How has he seen things change? What does he observe today? And then talk us through a little bit before we open up the floor to questions and answers in terms of what are some of the tools and tricks and tips that you have for senior executives like the ones on our session today to be able to identify burnout and then cope with burnout. So welcome, Shakun, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Anuradha. And I'm very impressed and fascinated that at you know, your CFO group, you are talking about this. This actually talks about or shows us how the world has changed and how far we have come. So it's a pleasure and a privilege to be here, discuss a couple of things, and in the process, learn from everybody here. You know, extended Zoom meetings and specifically monologues on Zoom could be a leading cause of burnout, right? So we don't want that to happen here. So therefore, I want to keep this very, very interactive. I mean, ideally, we should sometimes meet, but like it's very important because only one way absorption of information can actually be very, very tiring and boring as well, you know, let alone being enriching. So my request to all your guests and members today is just chip in, you know, don't worry about a Q&A section or don't worry about whether it is relevant or not. We are here to have a conversation and we will do that. Now, to your specific point of how the things are evolving, Anuradha, maybe I'll spend a couple of minutes talking about what is changing or has changed in the external environment. Now, change is something that has always been there, you know. All of us, whenever we started our careers, maybe 20, 25 years ago or more than that, have seen how the world has changed, how technology has evolved, how social fabric has evolved, how even our thinkings have evolved. But these last 2 years, what has happened is that everything has evolved at a much accelerated pace. And you know, when there is a slow and steady change happening, one, it is very easy to adapt to that change. I'm sure all of us have heard the story of the frog that was put into the water and then the water was warmed up and how it kind of adapted as the water started boiling. But in the last 2 years, what has happened is that everything has evolved at a very rapid pace. And as if it was a time travel, you know, we didn't realize 2 years gone by. But those 2 years created a permanent mark on some of the things that we were living day in and day out. And if you look at it, what are the few very big changes that have happened? I see that workplace and workers, these three pillars have dramatically changed, and there are shifts that have happened.
Sorry, what's the third pillar? You said workers and workplace?
Work itself. Okay. Worker and the workplace.
Okay.
Now, if you look at work, what does work mean? You know, so there were working hours and non-working hours. There was a workplace and then there was a home, right? Or whatever. Now, today, that thing is blurred, you know? It's just not there. People are working all the time and people are working from all the places, you know? And it's not just about maybe going to a club and working from there or working from the airport lounge. The other day I was in Rishikesh and by the river where, you know, people do rafting, there's a new little cafe come up, which actually is donning high-speed internet here. And the rentals have suddenly gone out because people are working from there. People are working odd hours. And when while people are working, the whole meaning and definition of work has changed. Work was something that we did to make a living in a specific period of time. And we actually sold our time. You know, I could be a full-time worker and I'm selling 40 hours of my time and so on and so forth. Today, that is not the case. A lot of organizations have let go of, say, attendance, for example, right? So work has become very outcome-driven. I know out there, there is this whole talk of moonlighting, for example, you know, and the corporate sector is grappling with that, and that is also causing burnout. So the definition of work has changed. What is interesting is that in all this, the shelf life of skills has dramatically gone down. Today, an average skill is expected to have a shelf life of about 3 years. Before the pandemic, that was at 7 years. And that's the dramatic shift that has happened over the last 24 or maybe perhaps 30 months. So that means that every 3 years, people will have to reinvent themselves. And it's not just the techies, you know, who need to learn new coding languages, but even people like you and I will have to do that, you know, because our engagement models are changing, you know. Perhaps the compliance requirement of the finance ecosystem are changing at a much faster pace. Earlier, when we started developing a skill or we picked up a career, we studied something and then it became our career like 24/7, you know. We lived and breathed whatever we were. Today, it is estimated that this career paradigm is shifting to something what I call as 20/7. So 24/7 has converted into 20/7. A Harvard study shows that people who are entering the workplace now, by the time they retire, they would have changed 7 careers and 20 jobs on an average. Now, when I say 7 careers, it means that today I could be a CFO, tomorrow I can become a wildlife photographer, third day I can start a bakery, then I can go back and start my career again in HR, and all these things are happening today. You mentioned about the meeting and the colleague that you met. I called up someone after a couple of years. I wanted some random advice from that person, a CMO of a very large organization. He said, "Yeah, Shakun, tell me what is it?" Then he told me that, you know, I have plugged out of corporate life and social life. I said, "What does it mean?" He says that I don't talk to people. I don't take phone calls because you are an old friend and you called after so many years, so I've answered your call, otherwise I don't even do that. So that's the kind of thing that is happening. The role of technology in work is changing, and I will talk a bit about it. Now, what it is doing to the worker specifically is that the aspirations of workers are changing. Now, if you have to change 7 careers and 20 jobs in your lifetime, it's very difficult to set a target and an ambition. Gone are those days that, unlike our generation, where we all thought that one day we'll become a CEO and that's about it. That's not the case today. People are now wanting to move to smaller cities, for example, maybe have very flexible working. They are not fascinated by designations and so on and so forth. And that's creating a lot of stress for us as people leaders. And that's a very important place. Now, because people are working from these kind of scenarios, the business models are changing. There's a lot more disruption that is happening. And therefore, leaders and professionals need to be far more creative, far more innovative. And it's a very big dichotomy, they say innovation stems from teamwork when people meet and socialize, but now you have virtual teams, people are not coming to the offices, what do you do? Therefore, the generation is getting divided. There are people who believe that flexi working is great. There are others who believe it doesn't work. There are people who believe that moonlighting should be allowed, for example. There are others who feel that is blatant cheating. There are people who believe that my work defines me. And then there are people who say that work is just a means to make some money and get defined elsewhere. So there's a big mess, if I may use that word, that is happening from a traditional perspective. We talked about new normal. I don't think there is anything normal about it. It's a new abnormal that is happening, because normal was the way we were used to it, right? Now it's all changing. Now in all this, what is happening is that the burnout rate is getting accelerated and the dimensions of burnout are evolving. Because it's very, very difficult to fathom that I'm sleeping long hours, I'm working from the couch, I'm still in my bedroom, still I'm feeling, weird. There's a very new term that got perhaps a month or two ago called the white collar lethargy. I don't know if some of you looked at it. I thought in this whole league, it was the latest white collar lethargy, and it's kind of hitting bad. So all this has happened. Now, because this has happened so rapidly, one very interesting thing has happened is that the acceptance of mental issues has become far more widespread and far more open. People are now openly talking about it. In fact, at Oracle, we did a research where we found that about 80% people in India are saying that they have that 2020 was their most stressful year ever. And about 63% people are openly saying that, hey, look, I need help. I need help. So I think it's a very interesting perspective and paradigm, because there was a kind of a taboo earlier, that was associated. And more from our perspective, when I say our perspective, I mean the CXOs, the senior leaders. There's a bit of there's a huge conflict that is happening, because we have work demands that are partly traditional and, the complexity is multifold. There is our own way of thinking and looking at things. We have got our own aspirations, our social structures and so on and so forth. And then we have this disruptive environment, technology, and most importantly, people to deal with, and it is causing burnout. The last thing I would say, Anuradha, on this context setting is the biggest problem of the CXO group is we don't know whether it's a burnout or it's the expectation of a role. Most of us, when we signed up for these high-stress corporate jobs, said that, oh, these things happen. Before the pandemic, at least I know we've had conversations of looking at our receding hairline and saying, oh, these are the rewards of a higher position, or a protruding paunch, and we say, oh yeah, long working hours, you can do only one thing. That is not acceptable. And I think today, if we are spending this much time, I think it's important that we identify what it means to be burnt out, either for yourself, ourselves, or for others. And therefore, what do we do? And also understand what this burnout, what this change is doing, which I'll touch upon But I want to take a pause here and come back to you or anybody else if you have any comment or a follow-up question.
I'm just saying, any questions, comments? I think it's important to just get some feedback from the audience in terms of, does any of this sound true? Has the instance of feeling of burnout been more common, let's say, in the last 2.5 years? And do we struggle with identifying this either in ourselves or in our teams?
Anuradha, this is Joydeep. I'm not sure if you can hear me.
Yes,
so, Shakun, I think you're absolutely spot on. Everything that you said, I mean, kind of 100% resonates with me. Absolutely. In terms of burnout and mental issues, yes, we're seeing that much more in our organization. As a matter of fact, we've given our employees a helpline, and we've had this for a couple of years, but statistics, I believe, show that in the last 2-3 years, the amount of calls that they've received have gone up. Mm-hmm. So people can call up that helpline anytime and talk to, they're an outside agency, an outside counselor, completely confidential. They won't reveal anything to anyone inside the organization or your colleagues. We've hired them, and that's what we're doing as an organization.
Very interesting. No, and you're right. Globally, actually, statistics are showing that the usage of these benefits, specifically around mental health, have dramatically increased. I will tell you, and most of all, you are CFOs here, so you'll understand. The ROI or usage of specifically these kind of counseling or mental health was at about 2%.
Right.
2%, you know, and a lot of organizations were saying, oh, these are just, items which are like hygiene factors, but nobody uses them. Today, on an average, it is upwards of about 35 to 40%. And maybe in your case, it could be different. So you're right.
Yeah. And we're also sensitizing people and telling them, look, it's not, it's perfectly okay to seek help, to seek mental health. It's not, it's just, don't feel shy about it or don't feel bad about it. Otherwise, the old conception, are ye to mujhe pagal bana denge. You know, the people will think I'm a madman if I seek mental help. So it's just like any other physical situation that you might come up, like you get fever or you get a headache or something like that. So this mental issue is again something very similar to that.
So while these are very good, these are things that help us overcome the burnout, help us manage, I think we also as leaders need to take a step back and understand what is happening. Why is it so aggravated today, even though people are talking about it? So we just now talked about the four or five things that are shifting around the three buckets of work, worker, and workplace. So what is it doing? So first of all, I think the biggest culprit is this always on culture. With the mobile devices and with the all sorts of things, we are always on, so it's like we don't have a compulsion to switch off. And therefore, even when we are holidaying, for example, I mean, I started my career when there were no mobile phones, let alone, 5G smart devices. So that was the time when if you were traveling or you were holidaying, you were really holidaying because you were cut off and there was no means. But today that's not the case. Even in your sleep, I mean, you get up for a glass of water in the night, middle of the night, you check your WhatsApp, you check your email. And that has a very, very depleting effect. In fact, I will tell you, research shows, and this is very important and perhaps the first action item I will tell you. If you check your phone, then it takes about 20 minutes for you to come out of that mental turbulence that it has created to go back to sleep. So if anybody who gets up in the middle of the night, if you check your phone, trust me, you've spoiled your sleep. It is a big myth that you can check your phone and quickly go back to sleep. It doesn't work like that. Even if it works physically for you, mentally it is not working. There is research proving that. So you need to find a way to avoid that. I will tell you what I do. I actually keep my phones and all my devices outside of the room that I sleep, and I lock myself inside the room. And we have this rule in our family that we will not keep any device in the room that we will sleeve. Now, does it have some challenges? Of course, right? One day, somebody was in an emergency situation. They kept on calling my phone. I didn't pick up. But yeah, I mean, they found help, right, or something. And then I do have a usual landline phone, which can start screaming and shouting if that need comes. So that's a very important piece. This always on culture has to, not culture, always on habit has to go. Now, the question is, where is this habit forming and coming? There's another interesting term called FOMO. We all have developed this fear of missing out, right? Nothing will happen if you will not. In fact, I will tell you, it's interesting. People take pride. I mean, I run an APAC role, and people take pride in the fact that, oh, I'm on a morning walk and I'm responding to emails. It's a stupid thing to do. No hell will let loose. You know, there are people who do that. I asked someone that, when do you sleep? In my team, she said, yeah, I sleep whatever. I said, no, but all the time your emails are coming. Then actually she said, I thought you will appreciate that. No, it is not. And I think that's the important piece. As leaders, we'll have to A, overcome the fear of missing out, and B, let other people come overcome the fear of missing out. And there are people who don't understand. I will give you a very interesting example, an anecdote. Early in the pandemic, you know, or middle of the pandemic, when all the companies moved on to flexi working, there were some weird things happening. For example, in one team or in one organization, they realized that the manager is insisting that the video should be on when you are in a meeting. Now, it's not possible, you know. I may not be just comfortable. I may be in a joint family setup. It could be anything. And people were just getting crazy about it. People were just, and a forward-looking organization actually released a memo saying that, look, the policy is, no, you don't have to do that. You don't have to do that. If you're not comfortable, don't do it. And it actually brought down the stress levels dramatically in the organization, because nobody thought about it. Middle-level managers thought that maybe this is a way to discipline, but it is not just a way to discipline, but it is creating a far bigger challenge there. You know, same is about attendance. You know, there were technologies that tracked that how many hours people are working on their laptops. Why do we need that? Because it's, again, I remember early on when I started the career as a management trainee, I would play Pac-Man in the evening on my system, only waiting for my boss to go. Because on the day when I was told that you can't leave till the time your boss gives. And what the boss is doing, boss is actually sitting in his room and waiting for his boss in the HQ to leave so that, you know, that happens. Now it's not required, right? Why would we do that? In fact, all these things are resulting that about 45% people are saying they do not get adequate sleep. And it is not just the number of hours in the sleep, but it is about the quality of sleep that you have. And again, research on neurosciences show us that you need to switch off about 2 hours before you go to sleep or go to bed to be able to sleep peacefully. And switch off means that don't even watch the news or the television, right? I mean, I'm saying that, but I will tell you and confess, I also have this bad habit. I sometimes just watch news for the last half an hour of the day thinking it will relax me and then immediately go to bed. It doesn't work. You get up 3 hours down in the middle of night, the same thought is still going in your mind. And often you get up in the morning without feeling adequately relaxed. The yardstick of a good sleep is that you start afresh. If there is anything from the previous day that is still lingering in your mind as you get up early in the morning, that means you didn't switch off properly. That means you did not shut down your system properly. And that's it may or may not cause. The other thing that is happening, unfortunately, is around this whole piece of substance abuse. You know, alcohol consumption went dramatically up during these 2 years. There are two types of people. People who became very healthy and fit because they went on the other side of the continuum. And then there were others who said, "Arey, my drinking has gone up or my smoking has gone up," and all sorts of things. An equal amount of people have gained tremendous amount of weight then the fitness. Only thing is that maybe out of shame, they don't post on Instagrams and Facebooks, and we think that the whole world is working out and getting healthier. That's not the case, actually, if you look at it. Because please understand, as a definition, we are saying that burnout is nothing but it is a result of chronic stress. It is a result of chronic stress, which could be mental or physical in nature, that has not been successfully managed. It's good to have stress. The point is, are we managing the stress successfully? And let me tell you, Virat Kohli, for example, has gone on record saying that how he was not able to manage his workplace stress and got into physical and mental trouble, which then translated. I don't know how many of you saw Prime Minister Modi was just interviewing him the other day on, what was that, National Health Day or something like that. So important pieces for us to understand that whether the signs of burnout are showing or not, it is causing an impact. So like I said, if you don't switch off properly, it has an impact. It may not show. It may not show. It's like smoking, right? I keep on smoking and say, no, I'm fit, I can run, I don't get any problem. It is impacting. And I think that's the biggest challenge out there, that people are not able to identify in time. Or it's like today the weather in Delhi is very good, but you know, another 2 months and it'll become a gas chamber. And if I choose to live here, no matter what, it'll have an impact.
Shakun, there are a bunch of comments. I'm going to read them out.
Please. I'm not able to see the chat. So yeah, please. Anuradha,
So Ayush Saraswat says that to some extent, I agree with Shakun. However, I feel that there are multiple attributes. Some employees lose motivation when they don't feel recognized for the work done, which has been common in the last 2-3 fiscals due to COVID-related cost-cutting measures. 2, manager-employee relationship seems too objective. Earlier, leaders used to personally involve themselves with their staff and have a higher level of engagement. People are attempting too many low-hanging objectives, multi-skilling, needless chasing, social engagements, OTT platforms, etc. He said many people could be okay with business as usual. However, some like dynamism. Companies need to ensure that employee engagement is well taken care of and the dynamic leaders are kept well occupied with meaningful stuff.
100%.
There's also a comment from Premlata. She says all of these things apply to us. The expectations from the organizations have increased manifold. People speak about work-life collaboration and not as a balance impacting physical and mental health.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I totally 110% agree. I think this is exactly what we are saying at the next level of detailing. When we say that workplace stress that is not managed properly, a conversation could be a great tool of managing that stress. Recognition from ages has been one of the best forms of managing stress. Relationships, workplace relationships, personal relationships, very, very critical and important. And I think expectations are rising. However, when it comes to well-being, the buck stops at the individual, no matter what, right? And therefore, the most extreme choice is people logging off, right? People changing careers, people changing jobs. But if you really look at it, at an aggregated level, everybody has an option to slow down and switch off, right? The company expectations will not go up, but at least verbally, at least on the face of it, everybody is saying this is important. And the question is, what happens when people choose this way? Today, if you look at it, and I will tell you, it is also generational. Today, there is a particular generation which feels very comfortable in saying no. And then there is a generation that doesn't like to say no. I will tell you, in Hindi, there is a saying, and then I'll translate to the extent possible. But in Hindi, they say, "Sabse bada rog kya kahenge log." And a lot of times, as senior executives, we have grown up with that external validation is very important. So yeah, maybe expectations are high. What will happen if I don't achieve my targets? What will happen if I say, "Hey, look, this is my workout time or my yoga time, and I will not take a call"? What will happen? Maybe some people will say, oh, he or she is not professional enough. Maybe somebody will say, you're not putting in enough effort. So what will happen? I think that's where the challenge lies. And in the same society today, there are people who are increasingly saying no. I will not generalize it by saying millennials or Gen Z or whatever, but the world is divided into these two generations clearly. Just now before this meeting, I had a call, and we are doing a very large event. A lot of people are traveling. Everything is happening. A very senior leader, he said that, look, I will come, but I will return back in the evening simply because it's my son's birthday the next day, and I will not work on that day, no matter what. And we were like a bunch of people looking at it. And I thought of my daughter's first birthday when I did not attend that, simply because I was proving to myself or the world at large that I'm the most dedicated and the hardworking person. It's not worth it. So every point, Anuradha, that you mentioned from the chat, I agree 100%. But I think if we have to avoid the negative impacts of burnout, which will only hit us, it will not hit our brand, our organization. They may even pay for our repair, but it will impact us. And it is not just physical or mental burnout. People are having social burnouts. People are having emotional burnout. A lot of people are having financial burnouts, right? And these are well-paid people. It's not that, because what happens is that these kind of things then get into multiple things. It's not about whether I'm earning enough money or not. I can still end up you all are finance professionals, so you understand. So I totally agree with everything that is being said. But yet I'm saying the buck stops at us. The external environment may be different or change.
I wanted to come in here, Shakun, and it's not like I want to play devil's advocate, but I do want to put another perspective out there. That one is this thing that you said about, son's birthday and whatever. I think that's great. But I also think that how do you make these decisions on a everyday basis, right? We make decisions every day. And I'll give you a very quick example. I used to have someone who used to work with me, I don't know, 10 years ago. And I don't want to trivialize it, but from his in-laws' sister's birthday party to the child's PTA to, some anniversary of the first time you met somebody to whatever, everything was either he needed a break or he needed time for. And I remember one day, finally, after a year and a half, telling him, firstly, the rest of the people in this office are not people without families and commitments, right? And the point is that as an employer, I'm not interested in people for whom the smallest personal commitment is always bigger than the biggest professional commitment. And how do you get people to understand? Because I think we all overcorrect. You're coming out of burnout and suddenly nothing personal is, nothing professional is important enough, and everything personal is very important, right? Or you're at a phase where you are high in your professional life and nothing personal counts and everything is professional. So I remember telling this person that in my team, I don't want people for whom every smallest personal commitment is bigger than the biggest professional commitment. And in my family, I don't want people for whom the smallest professional commitment is bigger than the biggest personal commitment. And the world is full of both of these people. How do you create a cadre of people who are saying, today it's time to be mom, today it's time to be MD, today it's time to be CFO, today it's time to be friend, today it's time to be daughter, today it's time to be mother or a colleague or whatever it is. That I think, how do we bring perspective, judgment, and enough, what I like to call sayam, into yourselves to be able to say, I respect the professional I am and I'm going to do the right thing by what needs me the most today.
I like the usage of word sayam here, Anuradha, and what a beautiful way you have articulated. In the olden days, we would call this person, or we will question this person's professional maturity, right? I think professional maturity is something which is utmost important today. Let me coin a new word, because I don't have a ready-made answer to your question that how do we do that. I think there is a need for us to develop a wellness maturity. You know, like professional maturity knows what is the boundary, where to stop, which is what is okay, what is not okay. I mean, after so many years, you're still in a zest talking about that person's lack of professional maturity to be able to understand how much is enough. I think we need a wellness maturity. Different people will have it differently. You know, for people who are not self-disciplined, you need to find ways and mechanisms. It's very simple. Can you define that? Okay, if I'm used to a 12-hour working day, I will get disciplined. It could be 14 hours, but let's reduce from 24 hours that is today. For others, it could be just their higher ability to say no. So I'm saying that wellness maturity largely will come when I'm questioning how many times I'm saying no. And some of the older techniques of you know, whether it is diet control or whether it is whatever, is just to say, am I saying no enough times? Whether it is to that external one extra dessert or extra drink or another extra party invitation and so on and so forth.
I mean, again, Shakun, I want to comment to say this is very personality specific.
It is absolutely.
I think there is a whole bunch of people who need to learn how to say yes. And I think for well-being, it is equally important to be in service. I think we are juggling between, again, always two extremes. People who struggle to say yes and people who struggle to say no.
Absolutely. And right? Wellness or well-being is all about finding that balance, Anuradha. There are people. So I will tell you, for example, a lot of organizations have now introduced the concept of unlimited vacations, for example. Now, there is a big possibility that somebody might just misuse it. And that's where we need checks and balances. And you are very right. It's very difficult. It is. And by the way, lack of work or doing minimal work is not necessarily a cure for or a method to avoid burnout. The laziest of the people can get into that. You know, it's about, do you have adequate stress, which is, you know, right up there, that your adrenaline levels are coming. So a lazy,
by the way, I think that's a great term for everybody to take away, right? Mm-hmm. That what is adequate stress? That some stress is good, or some level of stress which, you know, shows engagement or whatever. Yeah. It'll be good for you to elaborate on what does adequate stress mean? Why is stress?
Sure, I will tell you what adequate stress means. And that's a great thing. First of all, what we need to do, we need to define adequate stress levels for ourselves and constantly be there. Whenever that stress comes down, you need to pick up a new challenge, perhaps take up a new assignment, perhaps innovate, perhaps do something so that it brings to that adequate level. And just be mindful that when it is crossing the upper limit, the moment it crosses the upper limit, you need to bring it down. You know, it's like flying a plane. You know, you gotta define your air path and then just be in that. So that is important. Now, what does adequate stress means? Different people mean this means different. But if you look at the usual understanding from our perspective, what we say, first of all, we say that at least about 60% of your time, you are engaged in work that you enjoy, you like, and it does not leave you totally drained out. You know, they say that it's lonely to be on the top. I would say it is also draining to be on the top. So the step number one, Anuradha, would be to figure out at least 60% of your work is giving you positive kick. And again, I'm not saying it is about 60% of the time. It is not quantity, it is the quality. You know, it's like reading a book or maybe working on a balance sheet or whatever it may mean, structuring. So if more than 40% of your work is like what is bringing this white collar lethargy, I think that's the first red flag. It could be for you, it could be for your team. And how do you understand? That's where the flow is. You are not procrastinating that work. You are trying to be always there, constantly to be there. Therefore, what will happen, Anuradha, automatically, this kind of work never leaves you stressed out or burnt out or tired. You may be physically tired a little bit, which is fine, but you will not be mentally drained. And we've all seen that, right? I mean, I love to cook, for example, and if I've got friends over, I can cook for 4 hours and I will still feel rejuvenated. But then my daughter, who doesn't like to cook, and if she's forced into cooking, like just cooking an omelette would be a Herculean task for her. So I think we need to have that kind of thing. So anything above less than 60% that is not giving you positive stress, you got to change. Maybe delegate some work, maybe pick up something new, figure out what you need to do. That is point number one. Secondly, at the level of, there is a very interesting exercise, and you can find it on, there's something called as a circle of wheel of life, right? So what is wheel of life? Everybody would have seen that. Sometimes we kind of trivialize such things, but they're very interesting. Do a wheel of life exercise and see, just for the uninitiated, I will tell you. Imagine that it's a pie chart which has different, you have your financial well-being, you have your physical well-being, you have your social well-being, your hobby, your this thing. And just say that on a scale of 1 to 10, how satisfied you are with each of these dimensions, right? Now, one might say, I'm financially very satisfied, but socially not satisfied. So you will see that if these are the spokes of that wheel, one is taller, one is smaller, and then, of course, it's not a balanced wheel, right? So how do you say? So if majority of your pieces are by and large round, your wheel of life is kind of round, it is circular, then I think you're there. And the whole thing is that how do we increase the size? That's an important piece. Now, these are little more abstract things that I talked about. Question would be, how do we implement it? The simple little thing is to come to discipline, 40 minutes of physical exercise, some kind of mental thing, switching off, doing justice to your weekends, for example. I mean, if you could just keep a track of how many weekends you don't work, right? Whatever work is. Having a hobby, it is actually shown that having a hobby is extremely critical. If you are not practicing a hobby at least 3 times a week, again, it's a red flag. Do that, right? So do that. And these are the things that will create what I call wellness maturity automatically. And do that for your teams. I will tell you, and then we'll look at more comments. I just started a wellness month with my team. I said, do whatever you have to do. We created a little WhatsApp group. And I say, okay, let's post. I do 10,000 steps every day. So I post it. Then my team does something. Somebody does yoga. So it's also about building a community and bringing that camaraderie and doing that. So I've given you some very sophisticated, very, very, mental kind of models and very simple, basic things. Choose whichever works for you, but do something about it.
Yeah, no, I think those are good tips. And I think it's really about, there's a lot of, and I'm going to say something, and I'd love to get your reactions on it, Shakun. But Mr. Goyal has said here, in response to what I was saying, that working hours and weekend system is meant for balancing personal and professional commitments. Trespassing in either side creates these issues. And I have to say that one, I'm certainly one of those people who, it's not just 60%. I have actually been privileged enough to actually very seldom have had days where I haven't enjoyed my life. And I say life with a lot of thought because I'm not saying work. From the time I was very young, I have never differentiated buckets of personal and professional because I have believed that I'm an integrated human being who goes home and an integrated human being who comes to work. So if someone in my house is ill, it's not my personal problem. It is my problem, and that problem goes with me to work. And someone in my team needs to understand that today my behavior is going to be a certain way because I can't stop being who I am. I think it's very inauthentic. And I'll say this in a gender way, and I don't know whether there are people on this chat who might think differently, but women take this far more seriously. I don't want to take calls when I go home. And, there's this overt desire to cut off from work when you go home. And I remember many years ago saying to some of my colleagues that if you are okay to not be a mother, wife, daughter, sister, friend, daughter-in-law while you're at work, I'm okay for you to not be an employee between 5:30 in the evening and 9:30 in the morning and on weekends. But if you want to be all of those things every day of the week while you're at work, you should be okay to be an employee over the weekend. And there is basic civility that all of us bring in our lives where I'm not going to pester you if I don't need you. exactly the same way that I don't expect the home to intrude into your workspace if it's not required. But if required, I, as a free agent, needs to be able to take that call and say, right now, even though it is 11 a.m. in the morning, if I'm required for something domestic, I will do it. And exactly by the same logic, at 11 o'clock on a Saturday, if something at work needs me, I'm okay. But it allows me to have been a very integrated human being who's been able to allocate what I needed to my personal, to things at home and things at work as required, by not making these very artificial divisions between who we are. I think we have brought a very alien Western concept into our lives, because overseas, people need weekends to run chores. In India, we have the luxury of actually having enough and more time to be both things on all days. So I don't know how you are able to say, okay, I won't be all of these other things that I am during the week, and I won't be a working person during the weekend. So it's worked for me, and I feel very, I feel that it's important to be able to integrate your life, because it allows systems come together to help you when you have a personal challenge, and your life at home will support you when you have a professional challenge. But that's because the two are integrated. If you dissociate the two, I think you're suboptimal on both fronts. But that's my personal view, and I'd love to get some reactions to it.
The reason I'm not reacting, because I totally agree with what you're saying. It is, Mahatma Gandhi, by the way, said, you can't be two different people. Life is one single whole. You can't live your life in departments. So totally with you. I think the problem here, and what you have solved for yourself, and a lot of others should do it, is about liberation. It's about acceptance, you know. We've got our own what you call, you know, mental blocks. I'll share an incident with you. I was coaching a very senior leader. He said that, I don't know what has happened. There was this great person in my team, a lady, by the way, and she's great, best resource, but I don't know whatever has happened. She's just not able to work remotely. I said, what happened? Then we did some coaching. I said, go figure out something. Next day, he calls me that, Shakun, I'm in a big problem. I said, what happened? He said that, I just came to know that she has a big challenge and a problem with her mother-in-law. And because of that, they live in a joint family and really kind. Now, what should I do? What? I said, actually, whether you like it or you don't like it, you will have to resolve her mother-in-law problem. You can't run away from it. You can't say that, oh, it's mother-in-law and you and ye sab ghar mein hota hai, saas bahu, whatever it is, I don't know. It is impacting that human being. And at least the first step is that human being has shared the real vulnerability with you. You can't expect, I'm not a machine that you can switch off a particular functionality and then expect me to work. And I think that's a very, very liberating thought for the leaders, that we need to accept what is happening. I mean, we grew up in a environment where people would not even say that I'm having a headache. Forget about these things. Today, at least, we have seen in a single generation, people are saying, hey, look, I'm feeling depressed. I need help, right? So you are right, Anuradha, and I'm glad that you found that liberation, or you were born liberated, and that's how it should be. And when that happens, people work more hours. People are more productive, and there seems of research available showcasing that.
Yeah, no, I definitely live like that. But
in this case, we have last.
It'll be great to get some more. It'll be great to get some more reactions. What are some open questions for mental health? I mean, to test the mental health. Soumen Datta is asking, are there open questions to test for mental health? D.D. Goyal, I fully agree with every human being. One integrated person cannot be two separate, one at work, at home. But that's great. Agree with Anuradha, we are integrated human beings. Vikram, I very rightly said, but at the same time, the person as a manager and as an employee should be able to understand and judge the difference of priority. Absolutely. Once we see this behavior, organization managers are more than willing. Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that. Yeah.
There is only one question, and it's an age-old question. The question is, how are you? You know what is ironical, Anuradha and ladies and gentlemen here? We randomly ask this question and we don't even wait for the other person to answer that. If the other person answers, the other person's answers gives a hypocritical answer to a hypocritical question. My only humble request is, let's not ask how are you if we don't have the time, patience, and the intention of really probing into that person, that how he or she is feeling. How many of us have the guts today or the environment today that I can say that on a Monday morning, no sir, I'm not feeling well, I'm feeling frustrated, I want to, you know, throw this computer away. So if we can develop as leaders that kind of an environment where when you ask somebody how are you feeling, he or she is open enough, comfortable enough to answer that real question, and then you can set aside everything and address that, trust me, that 15 minute, that 20 minute will yield much greater employee engagement, much greater productivity, much greater whatever financial metrics you may have.
Sorry, I want to go back to Soumen's question. Soumen, I don't know whether you can explain this question more when you say, what are some open questions for mental health? I mean, to test mental health. And I'm not sure, Shakun, whether this is coming just from being able to understand it or for the fact that it has become such a standard refrain across the system that you sometimes don't know what to do with it.
Yeah. I'll wait for the clarification on the question. So while Soumen is typing that, I'll tell you, there are, by the way, a whole lot of free resources like simple quizzes available online also that you can take to kind of do a little, like I gave you the example of the Wheel of Life exercise. Today, there are some quick questionnaires that you can take and kind of get a little assessment of where you are on a burnout scale or I mean, I can send maybe a link or two, Anuradha, to you to circulate it to everybody. That's also a way of looking at it. But I don't know if Soumen has clarified the question further.
He hasn't actually. I don't know whether he can hear us or... I'm not sure, but maybe... I think for you to...
I mean to say, any form of questionnaire or something that we can test it in the form of organization point of view. That's why I asked the question, because not for like a denial, how are you, and something that. Any form of series of question on something, one on two.
Yeah,
on
as I mentioned,
that's so why I am asking for that.
Yeah, as I mentioned, there are, and I will try and pull out one or two and send it to Anuradha, who can then perhaps circulate to everybody. These are simple questionnaires that ask you simple questions and give you like a score or a bar chart of where you are.
Correct.
Yeah, they are available. Yep.
Okay, great. Okay, any other comments? I mean, I think this is, you know, it's a common struggle for all of us. But I think the real takeaway is that somewhere, instead of assuming that your mental health or your well-being can be taken care of by a more caring organization, I think the truth is that somewhere the responsibility of our well-being really does lie with us. The fact that we are all a part of an environment where our need to understand our well-being is higher than ever before. It's an unknown territory for most of us, and therefore it's important to be vigilant. And the small tips and tricks, if you recognize FOMO in yourself, please try and cope with it. Shakun, I have to tell you that I've been named the JOMO queen, which is on the joy of missing out.
Wow. Yeah,
I mean, I'm not sure it's a good thing. It's not. I'm not called that as a compliment, by the way, huh? But
But I would like to experience the joy of missing out. It's very, again, liberating. You know, it's gone. So what? Let go. I would still. Yeah.
But I think really it is somewhere taking the effort to understand our own mental health, acknowledging that mental health situation is not a weakness. It's a reality of the world that we live in. Doesn't have to do anything with our own personal being, character, whatever else. So less judgment around it, both for ourselves and the people around us. And I think the vigilance that is required, again, to recognize and the compassion that is required to acknowledge it within us and those outside. But small things, digital detox, time for yourself, picking up one thing that makes you feel good, whether it is yoga or art of living or therapy or running or exercise or whatever it is. I think these are very simple rules. I think for me, the most telling thing in terms of when Shakun and we spoke was that as leaders, we have trouble recognizing burnout in ourselves. We don't realize how deep-rooted it is and how long it takes to heal. Equally, our dismissal of other people's burnout, because if I have the capacity for 12 hours of work, to be able to acknowledge that somebody else can actually burn out at 7 hours or 8 hours or 9 hours, I think those are the things to become more vigilant of today. Good luck to all of us. And maybe we should use each other as support systems to be able to talk about these things. I'm very encouraged with the openness that we saw at our annual retreat, where, you know, our CFO community was very encouraged to see how open they were about talking about the challenges and the loneliness of being in leadership positions, of dealing with what has gone on, and how much just changing the way some of us have been, the old notions of leadership, trying to be not sharing stuff, not allowing ourselves to be vulnerable. All of those are little changes that we can bring about for this to be a somewhat easier journey than it could otherwise be. So thanks a lot, Shakun, for sharing those insights. And I look forward to all of us being just a wee bit better at dealing with burnout, recognizing it, and responding to it going forward. Thanks very much, everyone, for joining us.
Pleasure. Thank you so much. Bye.